Hello, this is Horror Studio One, and this is my unedited podcast. Hello, this is Horror Studio One, and I'm coming to you live once again with my unedited podcast. If I remember correctly, this should be my podcast number 23, which would be released on a Wednesday. Thank you, everyone, for your various gracious comments in my 21st podcast, my Death Note podcast, about the format you guys want me to keep doing my videos and my podcast. And I really appreciate that you guys took the time to go and comment there. I know what to do now. I know what kind of direction I want. And I'll tell you guys a bit about that before starting, obviously, the topic of the day. If you want to just skip my rant, my stupid rambles, please go to the description. I would have provided you a time where you can skip me. But are you really going to do that? Are you going to do that? Are you going to crush the soul of your fellow man? Go. Go ahead. Go do it. I know you guys won't do that to me. No, you guys. Real fans don't do that to their idols. I'm an idol now. Like those ones that stand, or statues or something like that, that people worship and pray. See how egotistical I am? God. Anyways, back to the topic. See, why would you skip this? This is pure gold. Gold. Anyways, so a lot of you guys have commented on that. Some of you said, most of you were generally favorable of the podcast, obviously, because you guys listen to it, right? If you don't like it, you probably won't click into it. But a lot of you guys were favorable. You guys don't hate it, at least. That makes me pretty happy, and it pleases me. You guys basically said, don't change the format, still upload it onto YouTube. I understand that. It's a lot easier to kind of get to, and you know, if you go to iTunes, you would have to go through a lot of stuff. You gotta download, you gotta like stream, you gotta maybe get an account. I don't know. It's really complicated. So as all of your favorable requests, I will keep the podcast on YouTube. I will change something though. But a lot of you guys have very honest, down-to-earth suggestions with my channel, because you know, a lot of you guys, I guess, like me, and that makes me pretty happy as a person as well, that I have people that follow me on the internet. It feels me pretty good. It's a success, you know, in 2015, that's like a success, you know. It's like, would you rather win $1,000 or have 1,000 followers? You know, most people would choose 1,000 followers now, I guess. You know, I guess it's our generation, it's our thing kind of thing. It's like, yeah, I don't know if you guys have watched an interview recently. Basically, they interviewed PewDiePie, and then they were saying, you know, the PewDiePie's gaming channel and just the YouTube phenomenon, you know, especially with gaming channels where kids would watch gamers play games. And people were like, why don't you just play the games yourselves? But it's a form of entertainment to watch another person fail, succeed, and get the thrills of that game. And it builds a kind of rapport with the audience as well, you know? It's kind of like a narrative story, an adventure. You're going on an adventure with that person. And of course, in the form of PewDiePie style, it's like a stand-up routine with a game kind of thing, right? He does a comedy routine, he makes me laugh and kind of thing like that. So people said that form of entertainment was like the rock and roll of the 1950s and 1960s. Like the moms and dads didn't understand. They didn't understand rock and roll. It is not music, you know. It's not how music is supposed to be. I just got a message. And same with YouTube videos. I think that is the rock and roll of our generation, where moms and dads don't get what's so intriguing. Yeah, you're watching some guy talk for 3 minutes, but it is a new form of entertainment. It's a revolutionary form of entertainment, and it's a turning point in how entertainment is going to be in the future, I think. You know, the traditional TV, it's I mean, you get like Netflix series, like, you know, House of Cards, all that kind of stuff. It shows how, you know, TV is being turned onto the internet, because that's where people are mostly watching their content nowadays. Anyways, that's the way people, you know, get their entertainment. So, you know, I think it's just a shift in the whole way that content is going to be produced. And I think it's an advantage for YouTubers like us, you know, to already be here, you know, because we're not going to be on traditional TV or nothing like that. This is our platform kind of thing, and everyone's coming to us. So we kind of get the home field advantage, in my opinion, when it comes to the future of, you know, performance and arts and that kind of stuff. So that's just the way I see it. I think YouTube is definitely the rock and roll of our generation, and it's gonna explode. Some people think that there's a YouTuber that I watch quite a bit. It's called Boogie2988. He's also like a gaming YouTuber as well, but I don't play games personally. I usually watch his vlogging series, and he talks about that, you know, the YouTube, like, who knows when, you know, shit will hit the fan, and, you know, this whole bubble of YouTube will explode eventually. But personally, I think that if it is gonna explode, it's gonna explode like a firework. It's gonna be crazy. It's gonna make a lot of money. It's gonna be a very profitable business. It's just gonna keep going and going. That's my opinion on YouTube. Ever since Google bought YouTube, I think a lot of people have, I guess, complained maybe because of Google Plus or, you know, a lot of that stuff. You know how they rate now, they rate audience retention as opposed to, you know, the views of a single video. So every channel is kind of becoming like a own TV channel, but on the internet kind of thing. They look at that more, and the audience you've built, more than, you know, viral videos on YouTube. And I think that's a pretty interesting thing. It allows creators to create a actual brand for themselves and an actual show, instead of just having random, you know, cat videos that reach, you know, 100,000s of views and stuff like that. And that's really important for people like me, I guess, who want to get my, you know, my message out there, my stuff out there, who like to perform. I'm allowed to have a platform for myself that I keep going and going and going, instead of creating shock value videos that only last 20 seconds, you know, because that's, I mean, all that's kind of going to Vine anyways, right? I mean, Vine, I think it's 6.5 seconds for a video. If you guys don't know what Vine is, you guys go check it out. I think everyone should know what Vine is. Amanda Cerny. Is that how you spell her name? I mean, how you pronounce her name? Amanda Cerny. She's very attractive. No, but I don't watch her vines. I watch her YouTube channel. So you guys can go check her out. She's pretty hot. Anyways, what are you doing? Anyways, so yeah, just the stuff I want to talk about. Actually, man, I've just taken a whole new thing. I was actually wrote notes on what to say today, but I'm like never gonna get to it or something like that, because I just took a whole new route. Okay, so basically there's gonna be a new direction for my podcast. What I was trying to say was that you guys have commented a lot, and you guys gave a lot of suggestions. I want to thank you guys for that. Instead of a daily podcast, I will still keep them on YouTube. They'll still be the same length, but I realized that I'm going to do podcasts 3 times a week, which is going to be on Monday, on Wednesday, and on Friday. And the reason for that is because I've had people comment saying that maybe my narratives have been falling short, and I personally do feel that as well. I feel like in the past 2 weeks since doing these, it's kind of fallen short. I've kind of lost focus a bit. I've become too, it's like, I mean, it makes sense for people to, you know, to be like that, I guess. You obsess over one thing for a while. I mean, I've been doing countdown videos, creepypastas for a long time. You know, when I started doing creepypastas, the part of my brain that was always working was kind of the creative part, because it was either narrating a story, an actual fictional story, or writing, which completely just, I use my creative brain for that, because I have to write it, create the atmosphere, select the music, select the pictures, and all that kind of stuff to put into a narrative. And then, of course, I started doing countdown videos, which were more, I guess, on the logical side of my brain, which I just recount stories that people have told, and I package it into a very good kind of like a good video with, you know, a good vibe, you know, editing skills kind of thing. So they were the two types. But when I shifted from, you know, just doing creepypastas to started doing countdowns, I mean, the same thing did happen. I mean, it's just that when I started doing countdowns, I got really popular because of doing countdowns. So I guess the effects didn't show that much there. But I kind of obsessed over doing countdowns, and I kind of stopped my, you know, my creepypastas for a long time too. So, I mean, not a lot of people, you know, recognize that, because I think when I was doing creepypastas, I wasn't getting as much attention as I was when I was doing countdowns. But the same shift happened when I was stopped doing countdowns and I started doing podcasts, right? And to be honest, the reason I shifted for those things is it's kind of like a breath of fresh air, you know. For the stories, I mean, when I first started, I wrote my own stories as well. So that was really the hardest thing. Like the process, I produced like one video every single, you know, couple of days. I mean, the longest was like 1 week of like I went without producing a video because to write something yourself and to edit it and to just continually make it in a good piece of art is the hardest thing ever, right? And then I start to narrate other people's creepypastas, which, you know, cut the time by half, basically, you know? It got a lot easier, so I started doing that. And when I started doing countdown videos, it was even easier, right? And now when I do podcasts, it's the easiest because I just ramble on and I ramble on, and that's like an episode already. So it's only human for me to just jump from one to the other, right? I mean, that's kind of why, I kind of, hold on to one thing once and I become obsessed with doing it because it just feels easier than what I did before, kind of thing. But just with the countdown vids to the podcast, it's just that, the podcasts aren't as popular, obviously. So the effects of that have been more prominent, you know, the growth has been a lot slower. And thus, you know, I feel like I kind of woke up to that a bit earlier, I guess, that I just can't do these all the time, right? You know, some people suggested maybe I start up another channel to do it, and I just didn't really feel like doing that. I mean, to start a channel from scratch all over again, even though, yes, I will be bringing, you know, you guys, some of you guys over there, I'd much rather just keep it here. So, to be honest, I'm going to be cutting down a bit of the podcast, to 3 times a week, so you know I can do other, you know, more interesting videos as well. You know, I just gotta stop, you know, obsessing over podcasts. I just gotta start up doing other things as well. Sorry, I stutter a lot when I talk, especially today. I'm tired or something. But today's the best time of day to record videos. I love doing podcasts in the middle of the day because I feel like energetic, you know, as opposed to night. I think you guys can tell when I'm like, oh, it's a late night, then my voice is kind of like raspy or whatever. But you guys say it's sexy, so that makes me very happy. Anyways, I'm hyper today, man. I drank tea. But yeah, basically I'll do podcasts Monday, Wednesday, Friday, and the other times I will do other videos. I'm trying to get, if you guys don't know, Korean 12 Real Ghost Asian Ghost Stories for Korea out. I've actually been working on that for quite a while, but it's been kind of, you know, on and off because it's really hard to get stories from Korea. I don't know why I can't find any that are legitimate and good and sound authentic to me. So hopefully I'll get that up to you soon. Doesn't have to be Friday. I realize I suck with those schedules, total shit with that, so I'm just gonna, you know, release it whenever I finish, and it hopefully is as soon as possible. So I apologize to you guys for lacking the narratives lately, but I'm back. Horror Studio One is back. So, but I will keep the podcast from Wednesday, Thursday, Friday. I'll do that until this week. But starting next week, it'll only be Monday, Wednesday, Friday. So, you know, when you on Tuesday, don't expect the podcast because there won't be, kind of thing. And yeah, like I promised, I'm gonna read a subscriber submission. And there's a ton of subscriber submissions, and I always wanted to do a subscriber submission and put it in a podcast because I can give my own interpretation on what's going on, and I felt this one was really special, and it kind of jumped out at me from the crowd. I apologize if I haven't gotten back to you yet. If you have submitted a subscriber submission for a ghost story or alien story or any kind of, you know, ghost rape story or nothing like that, I'm sorry that I haven't gotten back to you yet. There's been a lot. I get a lot of emails in my thing, so in my inbox, so I apologize for that, but I will get back to you whether I use your story or not as soon as possible. If I decide to use your story, of course, I'll get back to you and tell you that to check it out, because that is your story. So I want to thank all you guys again, but yeah, it's taken a while, but I will try my best. So this story is, I found it really interesting, actually, but I'm just going to read it out to you guys. It was emailed to me, actually, by someone named Pierce Corsego. So let's just read his introduction before getting to the meat of his story. First of all, you know what? Let's get a drink of water first. Because I know this one's going to be long, and I want to narrate it good, so. All right, so this is going to be the cutoff point for those individuals who don't like to listen to me ramble. So this story is by my subscriber, Pierce Corsego. First of all, I honestly love your work so much, and your unedited podcasts are my favorite. Thanks. I listen to it while I do my everyday things, and it makes my day 1,000% better. Wow. Anyways, I hope the story gets to go on your subscription story video. Nope, it gets to go into my podcast, bruh. You can use Pure C if this makes it. Oh shit, I'm sorry, bro. I totally just exposed your full name. All right, Pure C, we'll just ignore what happened before. This story occurred around 2005, and is a personal story of mine. I was around 5 at this time, and I lived in an area that was haunted. You know, phantom footsteps and random cabinets opening and such. But on one particular encounter, I was riding my bike around close to my house when this kid approached me. I don't remember how he sounded, but I remember that I couldn't see his face too well. I saw faint, sort of red scars one side of his face, and his skin looked pale. He was on a bike and stopped right next to me while I was resting. "Do you want to race around the block?" I remember him saying with a voice that sounded raspy. I looked at him strangely and I felt goosebumps running all over me. He kept on staring at me until I asked him, "Why do you want to do that?" He kept on urging me to, and I eventually gave in and started to pedal. I remember being right along this kid, and as I went faster, I saw him look at me with his eyes looking black, and I lost my balance. I fell on the rough concrete pavement, and I remember seeing the kid turn around to look at me, and as he disappeared and faded. The last thing I saw was his face with blood on the right side. The next thing I remember was me being inside my house. I must have passed out by the pavement, and my neighbor must have seen me. I remember standing by the stairs and my mom and great aunt cleaning my face. I looked at the mirror while I was crying in pain. Of course, and I remember on my right side of my face was the exact same scars and the blood all over it like the kid had on his face. I didn't see the kid the next day and have never seen him since. I live in New Zealand now, and that kid still gives me the chills as I write this. I don't know who or what the kid was, but I'll never forget him. Thanks again, Horror Studio One. I'm always looking forward to your videos. Have a good day. Pierce. Alright, so. Good story. I like that. That sent chills down my spine. I actually just read this story today, despite it was sent to me 3 days ago. I just read this story today, and oh my god, I fell in love with it. I got chills when I first read it, and I got chills while narrating. That's how I know that it's a good story, for me at least. That's how I know when I get that, you know, that goosebumpy feeling. And yeah, I want to talk a bit about kids and ghosts today. Why do kids see ghosts? I've always, you know, it's always been popular that kids, you know, they see the boogeyman. Kids and dogs are more susceptible to the paranormal and the supernatural kind of thing. That's always kind of existed. I personally, you know, I have always thought that as well. The reason for that, I think, is because kids, they've never been told no, you know. A lot of people attribute kids seeing ghosts to some sort of imagination or some kind of fantasy, you know. They take what they see on TV and they project it into real life. And, you know, in some level, that may be true. But I honestly think that kids see ghosts because their brains have not been programmed to say that ghosts don't exist, you know. Anything, you know, if you think about when you were a kid, anything was possible, you know. You could have done anything, right? Your future is bright, you know. You believe that anything, you believe that if you, when I was a kid, I honestly believed that if I jumped off a building and I stood on my feet, I landed just on my feet straight up, I would be able to survive. Like, that's how dumb I was as a kid. But it's not because you're dumb, it's because you don't know how the world works. So if a kid does see a ghost, it couldn't just be their imagination. It may not be, you know. It could actually be there, you know. That's just my opinion. But I do have an article that I searched up that said that they actually say that old people are more susceptible to seeing ghosts. So contrary to what popular beliefs about boogeyman and kids seeing ghosts under their bed, They believe that old people are more easily to see ghosts. And it says that older people are more likely to see the supernatural in life than children. The reason they believe that is because, people are more, it says here, people are more likely to see the hand of the supernatural at work in their lives as they get older. According to a study of the University of Texas at Austin, it attributes the causes for major life events like illness and death to factors that cannot be explained by science. What this article is basically trying to say is that because older people are more superstitious, they attribute more of their problems to, ghosts and the supernatural and stuff like that. It says that while only 26% of people in South Africa study believe that witchcraft could be the cause of HIV, more than twice that number, 57%, believe that a witch could cause a person to find themselves in contact with someone who had HIV. 38% combine the supernatural and the biological into one theory, agreeing that witchcraft, which is mixed with evil spirits and unprotected sex, cause AIDS. Okay. It's just that it's trying to say that because older people are more superstitious, they find, they're more they're easily to attribute their problems to the supernatural. But I think that's that in general, kids are more able to see, the paranormal kind of thing. That's just my opinion. I actually want to share a story. I was debating on whether to share this story in this video or create its own video out of it. I could talk a bit about it. When I was a kid, I had this one time, I was in Vancouver actually with my family, and I was really young. I was around 10 to 12 years old, and I was just, sitting in a restaurant with my family, and we were about to eat. We were just sitting there and stuff. And then out the window, I swear to fucking God, this really happened. It could have been because I was losing sleep. I was jet lag or something like that because we flew a plane there. But what I basically saw was that there was a giant chicken head coming through the view of the window. And it was like the size of Godzilla. So it was the size of a gigantic chicken. And its head just fucking came in at the window as if it was just pecking the ground. And I saw that. And I just rubbed my eyes and I was like, what the hell? And it was still there. I didn't tell anyone. I wasn't afraid, I wasn't shocked. I stood at this image of this gigantic chicken head, just basically, the side profile, crouched down in the window, in my sight. No one else said a fucking word. I just looked at it, outside that window. I don't remember how long, it must have been 5 to 10 minutes. I just looked at it like, I wasn't shocked, I wasn't scared. I just told myself, there's a giant chicken head out the window. I was around 10 to 12 years old, probably 11, because beside 10 to 12 is 11, so thus 11. That happened. I can't explain why, and it just went up and it disappeared. I never really remembered this story, but I suddenly just remembered this story and I wanted to share it. Yeah, I have no idea why. Even till this day, I don't tell anyone about this, really. I don't consider it anything, but it's just, I guess when you're a kid, you see more shit, the world is so mysterious. The world is so big. What could have that chicken be? Could have been a supernatural chicken, that enlarged in size that only, the kids can see, or people with, like a paranormal, senses can see, maybe. Who knows? But I will always remember that. And that contributes to what I'm trying to say today. Kids are more susceptible. Like the person in the story, the kid they saw obviously was not a human being. What kind of kid could have been? No one knows, but he was a kid and he saw it. So I want to thank my subscribers for sending me that story. It's a magnificent story. I'm not sure if I'll conclude it in my countdown subscription videos, but I definitely felt that it should have been explained here. So thank you so much, Pierce. And it was pretty creepy that the kid initiated that too. Do you want to race around the block? Man. That is some twisted shit, eh? That's some cursed shit. So he basically wanted Pierce here to have the same scars as he did. Maybe 10 years later, another kid will be there, and he'll see the same kid. Do you want to race around the block? Ooh, that's some scary shit. I'm getting chills all over my body. I hate ghost stories. Anyways, like I promised before, I talked about doing some subscriber videos. I'm going to keep this up. And yeah, just comment in the section below what you guys think about this story about, you know, by Pierce. And I'm sorry that this story was pretty short, I guess, for you guys expecting a 40-minute video of me just talking about this story. Come on, man. Come on. I write unedited podcasts in my title. So you guys just should expect that, right? Anyways, thanks so much again, guys. This is Horror Studio One. And yeah, I love all of you. And yeah, so for Thursday and Friday, I'll still have unedited podcasts up. I'll hopefully have other videos up as well. But next week, only 3 podcasts a week because I gotta leave time for other things, other videos, other content for you lovely people. So thank you so much again. This is Horror Studio One, and I will be going now. Bye-bye.